Well, then I'm
thank you very much, Judd. And thanks to Mike McConnell and to Judd and to the other people here at Stanford for convening this very interesting group of panels, which are really mind-stretching with new concepts that, that, frankly, we haven't come across, but undoubtedly we will. I'm going to ask a matter of personal privilege to discuss an issue that perhaps I should have discussed or should have asked in the question period on procedures, but I understood the question period to be questions, and so I didn't go into all of this. But I did want to bring you up to date with some procedures which are on campus now, today, recently. This is an opinion on the Ninth Circuit on April 7th of this year called O'Brien versus Welty. O'Brien is a student at Fresno State. And O'Brien, all these facts that I'm reciting to you are from a complaint. So I'm taking the complaint to be true. It was a 12B6 motion. He was a student at Fresno State who took umbrage at certain positions, which were the positions of the Chicano Latino Student Center. And one of them was that the student body president, who was an undocumented immigrant or undocumented worker, was supported by the university. The faculty supported the DREAM Act, and they had a separate graduation exercise for Latino students. O'Brien wasn't in favor of this. He also protested a poem which characterized America as robbed by the white savage, land of the biggest genocide, place of greed and slavery, rapist of the earth, etc. And then he attempted to enter the offices of two of the professors of the Latino Student Center to discuss and protest their support of this type of political ideology. And he was stopped by both professors, and they slammed the door in his face. The professors called the police. They charged him with intimidation, and a disciplinary proceeding started at the university, at Fresno State. The first thing O'Brien did, I'm going to go through some of the procedural steps to tell you, to show you what happened, although procedural due process was not urged as a ground for reversal, other grounds were, but I thought it was interesting, you should know about it. The first thing he did was to request the production of reports by all students or staff or administrators that talked about this this incident, and that request was refused by the dean. He requested to bring an attorney to the judicial conference at which he was going to be offered a stipulated sentence. That request to bring an attorney was denied. He requested to be allowed to videotape the judicial conference. That request was denied. He did bring an attorney to the judicial conference. The attorney was not allowed to participate. He was finally charged, and then he had a judicial hearing, and he was told he could have a non-attorney advisor, but not an attorney. The hearing was before a Fresno State faculty member, and O'Brien asked to record the proceedings. That request was denied. He requested a copy of the recording of the proceedings that was made by the universities. That request was denied on account that that recording was university property. He offered in evidence a videotape with sound which he had made of the incident when he tried to talk to the professors and they slammed the door in his face. This offer of evidence was also denied. He asked the hearing officer report finding O'Brien had intimidated and harassed the professors was not given to O'Brien, and so that he could raise objections to the findings. So that was those are the procedural steps which were being taken very recently on a California campus. With respect not to sexual misconduct, but with respect to the issue of political speech as to a student. Well, Let's turn to the subject matter of this panel, which is the role of the university. The role of the university, is it a place for unfettered exchange of ideas or for the molding of young minds and responsible citizens? I think we'll be discussing questions such as this. Is the university acting in loco parentis, using its authority as a basis for shaping the character of young people entrusted to its care? If so, who decides what values to impart? Does the university have a special obligation to maintain an environment of free inquiry? Is it acting as a government towards adults with special obligations because students are living on its property? Is it acting as an entrepreneur responsive to the tastes and desires of its clientele? How does Title VII affect any of these obligations? With respect to any of these questions, are private universities fundamentally different from public universities? To discuss this, we have three distinguished panelists. Immediately on my left, Peter Berkowitz, who is a Tovey Senior Fellow at the Hoover Institution. He writes and studies about, among other things, constitutional government, conservatism and progressivism in the United States, liberal education, national security, and law and Middle Eastern politics. He holds a JD and PhD in political science from Yale University, an MA in philosophy from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, and a BA in English literature from Swarthmore. Left off of his bio on the Hoover Institute is the fact that he also taught at Harvard from 1990 to 1999 in the Department of Government Political Philosophy. To his left is Marianne Case from the University of Chicago Law School. Ms. Case is a graduate of Yale College and Harvard Law School. She studied at the University of Munich, litigated for Paul Weiss, Rifkin, Wharton, and Garrison in New York, and was a professor of law at the University of Virginia before joining a law faculty at Chicago. Among the subjects she has taught are feminist jurisprudence, constitutional law, regulation and sexuality, marriage, family law, sex discrimination, religious freedom, and European legal systems. To her left, Professor Mark Yudof, who's the president emeritus of the Berkeley School of Law, formerly known as BOLT. Professor Yudof served as the 19th president of the University of California from 2008 through 2013. He is a professor of law at the University of California. He served as chancellor at the University of Texas system from August 2002 to 2008, and as president of the four-campus University of Minnesota from 1997 to 2002. He served as the dean of the law school at University of Texas at Austin and as the university's executive vice president before that. President Emeritus Yudof is a renowned authority on constitutional law, freedom of expression, and education. A Philadelphia native, he earned both an LLB and BA degrees in the University of Pennsylvania. We lead off with Professor Berkowitz.
Thanks very much. I want to add my thanks to Professor McConnell and to Judd Campbell for putting this great event together. If I supported trigger warnings, at this moment I would issue multiple glaring red alert trigger warnings. Instead, begin with a quick story and try to tie the issues from yesterday and today together. As a young assistant professor, I had a distinguished senior colleague, Judith Schlar. One day I asked Mrs. Schlar, as everybody called her, what do you think the connection is between moral education and liberal education? She said to me in her characteristically authoritative and sharp way, Peter, if your students aren't moral by the time they set foot in your classroom, there's not very much you can do to make them moral by the time they leave. What she meant, I think, was that it's not your job, my job, to preach in the classroom, and that in any case, good behavior, the virtues acquired through practice and habit. That's true. At the same time, it seems to me, liberal education is itself a form of moral education. True liberal education involves a set of practices that foster the virtues of freedom. These include free and systematic inquiry, robust and uninhibited discussion, and a community constituted by rules that recognize the dignity of each individual. The question for the panel is whether universities should stand for robust, uninhibited discussion, or rather, should mold young minds and citizens. Obviously, this is a false dichotomy, but it is a useful false dichotomy because it brings out a very useful restates a useful misconception. Many suppose that promoting free speech impairs students' character. The expression of hateful views, they say, injures the hearer and degrades the speaker. This, of course, can be true. Then again, in athletic competition, we have winners and losers. And losing can be excruciating, and the pain can last for a long time. We don't, therefore, outlaw sports. In no small measure, the value of a liberal education to the individual and to the public stems from a distinctive quality of mind and character that liberal education fosters with the help of freedom of speech, which depends on free speech. That's the ability to explore moral and political questions from a variety of angles. It involves the capacity to put yourself in somebody else's shoes. It involves the ability to understand the weaknesses in your own views and the strengths in the views with which you disagree. It promotes toleration, civility, and mutual respect. In On Liberty, John Stuart Mill called this quality of mind and character many-sidedness. Mill provided a wonderful example of many-sidedness in the London and Westminster Review, which he edited. Think of it as the Atlantic of its time. In 1832, Jeremy Bentham passed away. Bentham, the great rationalist, progressive utilitarian. 2 years later, Samuel Taylor Coleridge passed away. Conservative, romantic poet. Mill wrote tributes to both men, and in both tributes he emphasized both of them were indispensable teachers to all educated men and women. Now think how unusual it is today for professors, and for that matter for curricula in our universities, to really embody this notion that it's indispensable for an educated person to know both the great representatives of the left and the great representatives of the right. Free speech will be a dead letter on campus unless universities organize their collective lives in conformity with the principles of freedom and educate students for freedom. Freedom of speech is not a standalone principle. It's not an isolated practice. It is bound up with a variety of principles and practices. Lose one and you endanger the whole. Accordingly, to make robust exchange of opinion a reality, universities must also restore due process and campus disciplinary procedures. In addition, universities must reform the curriculum by reinstating core requirements and depoliticizing the classroom. Start with freedom of speech. I review from yesterday, quickly. Threats to it on campus attract considerable attention these days, justly. The creation of safe spaces and free speech zones, the demand for trigger warning, the policing of microaggressions, the exaltation of diversity and inclusion as the university's supreme values, whatever their motives, these involve hemming in and regulating speech and punishing offenses, punishing what the authorities deem offensive. Of course, it's desirable for professors to treat delicate subjects with delicacy. All should avoid thoughtless and discourteous utterances and gratuitously giving offense. And genuine diversity and genuine inclusion are genuine goods. But universities should not be divided into safe spaces and free speech zones. If the university as a whole is not a free speech zone, it's not a proper university. If students don't like what they're hearing, they should retreat to the privacy of their dorm rooms. All universities should issue a single trigger warning. It should be in the student's letter of acceptance. And the university should explain, it is in the nature of liberal education to confront challenging and disturbing opinions. You will routinely encounter such opinions, both in the classroom and outside of it. If for whatever reason, and through no fault of your own, you're not good with challenging and disconcerting opinions, then you undertake liberal education at your own risk, or perhaps you should avoid it altogether. Microaggressions, what we used to call slights, inconsiderate comments, and implied insults, should be beyond the purview of university authorities. They should be dealt with in the venerable way, ignored or countered with more and better speech. And while the university should welcome men and women of every background on equal terms, the university should understand diversity in a way that enlivens and does not stifle debate, and inclusion in a manner that does not exclude or stigmatize those who think differently. Free speech is also bound up with due process, because due process is the vehicle by which the authorities demonstrate that they're willing to listen to both sides of the case. Yet universities are have been diluting due process in disciplinary proceedings. What drives the dilution of due process? First, a false perception of crisis, or the promulgation of a false perception of crisis. The Obama administration has repeatedly publicized the finding that 1 in 5 women on college campuses will be subject to sexual assault. This is a repeatedly debunked finding. The best statistics from the Department of Justice tell us the number is something like 1 in 53. Yes, that's too much. Yes, every sexual assault is a heinous offense, and those who commit them should be punished to the full extent of the law. But there are no grounds for emergency conditions, meaning the dilution of due process. Then there is, we've discussed it a bit, the April 2011 Dear Colleague letter, which instructs universities and colleges, on pain of losing federal funding and being subject to federal investigation, to dilute due process. The OCR effectively changed the law. No congressional legislation. It did not go through the notice and comment rulemaking procedures to which federal agencies seemingly are subject. So it's now common on campus disciplinary procedures for universities to deny the accused counsel, the ability to cross-examine witnesses, access to evidence used against him, and an impartial adjudicator. And last, I'll develop a point that Professor Soup made. There is the influence of legal theory, specifically the internalization among university officials of the doctrines of Catherine MacKinnon. More than 25 years ago, MacKinnon suggested, to great acclaim and toward a feminist theory of the state, that we live in a, quote, male supremacist, close quote, society, in which all sex is presumptively sexual assault because in such circumstances, women are incapable of giving meaningful consent. It is this theory of the pervasive subjugation of women that spurs universities to impose on men the responsibility to obtain affirmative consent, yes means yes, at every stage of sexual relations. It's this a theory, by the way, that explains why affirmative consent is never enough. Affirmative consent in practice at universities is a snare and a delusion, because yes can always be reinterpreted as coerced. I quote from a Yale document, emotional coercion. And the authorities at our universities are only too ready to so reinterpret yeses as expressions of, as reflections of emotional coercion. Lastly, like the evisceration of due process, the hollowing of core curricula erodes the conditions under which free speech flourishes. Sure, our universities featured distribution requirements, but all students know these are a joke. You take a small sampling of courses from the humanities, social sciences, and natural sciences. This teaches a lesson that the universities believe that there's no common foundation of knowledge. Or worse, it teaches a different lesson, that there can be no such foundation. The hallowed curriculum is also a politicized curriculum. It is infused with progressivism and it omits conservatism. The curriculum implicitly teaches that there's only one right, just, and true moral and political perspective, The others reflect ignorance, waywardness, moral depravity. To see the conflict, to see the connection between the hallowed curriculum and the politicized curriculum, consider the standing of the American constitutional tradition in the curriculum. Very few of our leading colleges and universities require students to study the American constitutional tradition to graduate. Yet how can you understand American politics without it? It gets worse. Suppose you wish to study conservative ideas at one of our great universities. There are very few courses that feature even one of the makers of modern conservatism, let alone courses which feature the writings and careers of, say, Hayek, Buckley, Russell Kirk, Irving Kristol, and others. It gets worse. There is little study on campus of the principles that underlie liberal education, the truly liberal principles that explain why everybody should study conservative ideas, even especially non-conservatives. The study of the classic of the genre, John Stuart Mill's On Liberty, has fallen into desuetude. So too has his key contention. He who knows only his own side of the case doesn't even know that. The exclusion of conservative ideas from the college curriculum is illiberal in effect and often in intent, and it has political consequences. It begets smugness among progressive students. It teaches them to despise conservative voices as unworthy of discussion and debate. And it stokes resentment among conservative students who witness the scornful dismissal of their opinions. Small wonder that our politics is polarized and that our public discourse is degraded. The debasement of liberal education, of course, is not the sole cause of this sad state of affairs, but it is the cause most closely connected, that most directly implicates our university. In conclusion, liberal education is education for liberty. Its traditional purpose and its continuing justification is to prepare students to exercise the rights and shoulder the responsibilities for freedom. Too much of liberal education, however, has become illiberal education, training in intolerance and in moderation, in a word, single-sidedness. To provide a properly liberal education, colleges and universities must reform the curriculum by introducing all students to the principles of moral and political and economic freedom, to the continuities and controversies that constitute American history and Western civilization, and to the diversity of practices and beliefs in other civilizations. In addition, our colleges and universities must also govern campus life on the premise that students are free and equal individuals, not victims and oppressors. This means upholding fundamental fairness and due process in campus disciplinary procedures. And our colleges and universities must institutionalize the unfettered exchange of ideas. These steps will go a long way toward enabling universities to do what is properly in their power to cultivate in their students a character fit for freedom. A properly liberal education serves students' interests and the public interest. Thank you.
Professor Case?
Thanks so much. So yesterday evening at the cocktail party, when Mark and I were talking briefly about the panel, his question to me was, so what's your shtick going to be? And that was exactly my words when Michael McConnell first called me. I said, would I come to this? I said, this is not something I have a shtick on. This is something that I don't even know that I have a fixed point of view on. It's something I've, to some extent, avoided developing a fixed point of view on. I'd be happy to come because, given what I do for a living and where I do it, these are the sort of questions I should develop reasoned opinions on. But these opinions are very much a work in progress. And I'm going to begin by fighting a hypo. And I thank Peter for eloquently setting up the problem with the second half of the question so that I will have to talk less about it. He is quite correct, and I would have said if he didn't, a place for an unfettered exchange of ideas or for the molding of young minds and responsible citizens is a false dichotomy. This is either both and, potentially neither nor, but certainly not dichotomous. So I'm going to devote all of my remarks to fighting the first part of the topic, the role of the university, which assumes, I think, incorrectly, that there is one answer to this question, that there are not different roles for different universities, not just public and private, but small and large. Colleges may have a different function from research universities, and there is room for diversity even within that. So one other sub-theme of my remarks is going to be, I was disappointed to see that there wasn't something about religious civil liberties on the program here. And this is not religious civil liberties, but I'm going to begin and center my remarks in the text from the New Testament that has appeared in countless of my law review articles, even though I am not a believer. It comes from what Donald Trump would call 1 Corinthians. And it's, there are diversities of gifts with the same spirit. And it is that spirit that I want us to address, that whether we look at the analogy of the university to the family, to the workplace, to the hometown or residence of its students, or to a product that is sold to consumers, there is room for a diversity of gifts with the same spirit. And you know, let me mention, throw out a few conventional ways we think of this kind of diversity and invite you to think of the further about the analogies and disanalogies here. So for example, think about TIBU sorting. Famously has its problems, but if ever there was a time for TIBU sorting, that is, TIBU sorting, for those of you who are unfamiliar with it, and those who are more familiar than I, please forgive this perhaps incorrect, very quick summary, suggests that for local governments, they put together a bundle of goods and services and attitudes that people may then choose to elect to migrate to, whether local governments on the level of states or local governments on the level of neighboring communities may have different views about how much to spend, for what kind of services, what kind of regulations to have. And if there's ever, I mean, it's, you know, it's notoriously difficult to up and move from one state to another and one town to another. There's ever an opportunity for relatively low cost to engage in this sort of TIBU sorting, it's with respect to choice of universities, because there are a lot of universities and colleges in this country. Transferring from one to another if one has made the wrong choice is not so difficult. One doesn't spend one's whole life there. And the universities are far more in the business than they were when I was applying to them, in the business of marketing themselves, that is to say, telling students exactly why to come here or there. Some other ways to think about this are famously the Brandeis Laboratories for Experimentation. So if we think of this as either permanent experimentation that has to do with a diversity of tastes and preferences, or in the way that Brandeis more often thought about it, which was genuinely in the experimental model, that is to say, we've heard a lot from a lot of people that we do not even yet know what best practices are. Well, experimentation may work along these lines. I, as noted, do comparative law, and the comparisons I draw are usually to European law. People who've studied the European Convention and the Court of Human Rights may be familiar with its doctrine of the margin of appreciation. That is to say that there is a core of a certain right, and then there is a certain level of degrees of freedom that a nation may have with respect to rights other than the few that are absolute, such as the right to be free of torture. But free speech rights, for example, are ones that countries can subject to such limitations as they reasonably believe to be necessary in the interests of certain defined goals. So I come back to yesterday's panel on free speech, and I say, you know, public universities are bound by the First Amendment. Even there, as I'll get to in a moment, there's room for potential diversity as to how the First Amendment can be actualized on the ground in certain circumstances. But private universities, which Catherine Ross correctly said very often announce their commitment to free speech principles, need not, except perhaps in California, have those principles be the principles of the First Amendment. And there should be that kind of room for diversity. Let me give you, before I go on, two concrete examples of the kind of diversity I have in mind here. So with respect to public universities bound by the First Amendment, I'll give a religious example, that of the Christian Legal Society, which the Supreme Court of the United States said with respect to the University of California Hastings College of Law's policy, that it was perfectly acceptable, consistent with the First Amendment, for the Hastings College of Law to have what it called an all-comers policy, requiring all student groups, even the Christian Legal Society, to take all comers. They'd said that that was not constitutionally required, but it was constitutionally permitted. So and Justice Kennedy, in oral argument and in his concurring opinion, talked about why one vision of molding young minds and responsible lawyer citizens might go along with an all-comers policy. Although many people, including Michael McConnell, I think, would disagree with both the policy and its upholding. Another example on the theme not of speech and religion, but of and association, but of sex, I've been a longtime fan of the Antioch rules. I was a fan of them when they were first promulgated by students in Antioch in the early 1990s. I've been teaching them in my class on regulation and sexuality continuously since then. They have now, in 2005 or 6, they were made the rules of Antioch College for the first time, and now they are getting much more play. That is to say, requiring express verbal affirmative consent for every step in a sexual interaction. I am not suggesting for the moment that every college and university should adopt the Antioch rules or be subject to Title IX problems or even my moral opprobrium. But I do think that there is something to be said for Antioch saying this is our norm, and under either an experimental version or a marginal appreciation version of diversity, there's room for this. Even if we think of the example of the university as in loco parentis, different parents have different approaches to parenting, and one is not lexically better than another. Some push the young out of the nest early, some nurture and safeguard them longer. You don't get to choose your natal family. You do get to choose your college or university and to transfer if you've made a bad choice. There may well be, as with family, a baseline issue, something that will be the university equivalent of parental abuse or neglect. Also, though, if we are, as some colleges are doing, reinstituting the familial model, there are things I think are beyond the pale for the familial model, because just as the legal family is not as patriarchal as it used to be, I would like to see the university family not be as patriarchal as it used to be, and therefore I'm disturbed by, for example, the briefing of Notre Dame College in its ACA Affordable Care Act contraception case, and forms part of another project I've been talking about in a different context, which I call the new feudalism. That is to say, it seems to me that our rights are now more and more, rather than less and less, a function of our hierarchical attachments. We can choose our employer, our church, our state, and then various things come along with it. I'll just read the quote from Notre Dame that so disturbs me. In its case, it said, quote, "Just as a Mormon might refuse to hire a caterer that insisted on serving alcohol to his wedding guests, or a Jew might refuse to hire a caterer determined to serve pork at his son's bar mitzvah, it violates Notre Dame's religious beliefs to hire or maintain a relationship with any third party that will provide contraception coverage to its plan beneficiaries," unquote. That's the familial metaphor with a vengeance. I don't think even the students, but certainly not the employees of Notre Dame, or in the relationship to Notre Dame, that is that sort of familial relationship that's suggested. But a different sort of familial relationship has come up in the context of the Yale College Halloween disputes, where, as I'll conclude with, a student who was vilified by the conservative media, said in a admittedly extremely angry and upset tone of voice to her college, what was then called her master, as of a week ago we are determined to call them head of college, the master of a college, what you are providing is a home for us. And Yale University, I think, is on one end of the spectrum with its collegiate model, its requirement that students live on campus. Another one of the religion cases that I had in mind to talk about is Hack versus the president and fellow of Yale College, where Yale said, we have a norm that students live on campus for their freshman and sophomore years and in an integrated environment. And even when students who are observant Jews and have an objection to the possibility of accidental encountering of persons of the opposite sex in the dorm rooms in states of undress, again, you choose to come to Yale, you choose to accept our norms on this. I'm way out of time, so I'll say a couple of things. That my own background is what leads me to this. I chose a law firm, Paul Weiss, that had very, and Cravath, had very different norms from Debevoise and Davis Polk. I spent time at the University of Munich, a commuter school, which does not purport to be a home or a family for its students, as well as at Yale College. I spent a decade at the University of Virginia, where male or female, if you're a gentleman, you succeed. Male or female, if you are not a gentleman, that is to say, polite and in accord with social norms, I can say more of this in the question and answer period, you don't. I went to the University of Chicago deliberately. It's no accident that I'm at one of the schools that FIRE thinks has got a great policy, but that is a taste or preference that the University of Chicago has, which is very different from that of the University of Virginia. And the University of Virginia, a public university, I think is perfectly in accord with the First Amendment in its approach. I'll finish very quickly with noting something that troubles me, which is two of the most recent controversial examples of the problem of speech on campus, the Yale Halloween debates and the Georgetown, your hero was a stupid bigot and we are not sorry that he was dead debates concerning the death of Justice Scalia. All, in my view, as a First Amendment lawyer, involve exactly what some people yesterday were calling for, which is simply speech countered by more speech. Every step in the process was just speech. I'm particularly distressed to see someone like Randy Barnett say that it is a problem. I mean, time doesn't permit me to go through both, so I'll do the Georgetown example. Georgetown example, Dean Traynor says, Justice Scalia, we will all miss him. Mike Seidman, a professor there, says in an email to the faculty, I disagree with these, I'm shortening radically. I disagree with these sentiments and that expressions attributed to the Georgetown community do not reflect the views of the entire community. Gary Peller, community should be thankful for Scalia's willingness to meet with our students, but he was not a legal figure to be lionized or emulated. He bullied lawyers, the Georgetown community. In my mind, he was not a giant in any sense. The Georgetown community that I feel part of would never have claimed that our entire community mourns the loss of Justice Scalia or contributed to his mystification without regard for the harm and hurt he inflicted. Randy Barnett then expresses his own sense of personal that he was wounded by this as a friend of Scalia who mourned him. But then that, of course, is his right and unproblematic. But he then objects to the email being circulated to the broader student body, saying, although this email was upsetting to us, we can only imagine what it was like for the conservative students on campus. Some of them are 22-year-old 1Ls. They have reached out to us to tell us how traumatized, hurt, shaken, and angry they were. A particular concern to them were people who were in Professor Peller's class, who must now attend class, knowing of his contempt for Justice Scalia and his admirers, including them. How are they now to participate freely in class? What reasoning would be deemed acceptable on their exams? And I think the particular case of Justice Scalia is interesting, because he was a sitting Supreme Court justice making decisions which will be and have been different now that he is dead. And in the same sense that we have the king's two bodies, we've got the two bodies of Justice Scalia. So I don't think it is necessarily a personal death wish or anything at all troubling to say that the death of someone in power, which incapacitates his continuing to use that power in ways that the speaker, for reasons the speaker has articulated in ordinary legal norms, is bad, that person's incapacitation is not something necessarily to be sorry about. I'll end there.
Thank you. I wanted to thank Professor McConnell and Judd, and I'm always happy to come to Stanford, having spent 5 years as president at UC Berkeley, at University of California, and often in Berkeley. It seems so pastoral here. I don't need 20 police officers to protect me. I don't have hundreds of people outside. I don't. There may be a few anarchists in the room, but I don't know you. If there are occupiers, they're someplace else. I agree with what's been said. It's a false but useful dichotomy to talk about unfettered exchange of ideas and the molding of responsible citizens. And it's I teach in the K-12 educational policy and the law. And you can't talk about education without what I call socialization, or what you might call Peter might call moral education. It's always infused in it. You may not intend it, but it's always there. You make curriculums. Selection decisions, you wait in line, you have class size, you have certain deference to teachers or whatever. There's always socialization. So all education socializes and molds. Now, my view is somewhat different from Mary Ann's. I mean, I'm a diversity maven. It's great. I don't think Catholic colleges have to necessarily teach abortion rights. And I don't think all private universities have to be alike and so forth. But we do have an overriding democratic ethos in this country. And I think it is not just the Thiebaud hypothesis. There's a reason. The students, the faculty, they demand certain rules on academic freedom and freedom of expression the fact that a professor, even at a private small university, shouldn't be punished for her views that she published in print or a speech that she gave. So I would say for me, this is very similar to what Peter said, I favor socialization to democratic norms, such as freedom of expression. And it is in bad shape, and diversity is not a response to that. That socialization is in bad shape today. You have people who try to shut down other speakers on campus, and they're arrested afterwards. Because it wasn't just holding up a sign or booing or anything. They physically wanted to stop the speech from taking place. And I have a lot of experience in this. A third of the Board of Regents meetings, University of California, were shut down to clear the room. They would not let us do our business, even after extensive comment periods and the like. Frequently, I resented it. They wanted to go for my throat. I thought that was a very bad idea. And what they will say is, there are two arguments, both of which are bogus, in my judgment. One is, we don't like what you're saying. We have a constitutional right, not just a prerogative, we're not just to shut you down. So when Moshe Habertal was interrupted at Minnesota, and after half an hour or whatever, they finally took them out of the room. They were very tolerant, and they were arrested. I assume, they probably were released. That's what usually happens. They said that their First Amendment rights have been violated, that their rights trump the There's not one United States Supreme Court decision that stands for that. That's not even a heckler's veto. I mean, killing the speaker is not a heckler's veto, as typically understood. And the other is, so that's you get the last word principle. But then there's the first word principle, which I really like, which is that if someone speaks and you disagree with them, it's an effort to silence them if you're a part of, I don't know, it could be anyone, but I guess certainly if you're an administrator. So I was at a synagogue, and someone said, what do you think of this this panel discussion at UCLA. And I'll tell you what I said. I said it was very biased, in my opinion. But I wouldn't do anything about it. I believe in free speech. And there are other voices at UCLA that have different ideas. That's really all I said. I got a letter from 120 professors, alleged professors, purported professors, crypto professors, who wrote to me that I had violated their academic freedom by saying what I said. So I wrote back. I thought, these are not necessarily legal scholars, but I'll write back. So I wrote back and said, you know, the last time I read the First Amendment, it didn't have anything in there that if you criticize what someone else had said, that that itself is an effort to silence the other side. Now, of course, it may silence it, but that's the way the First Amendment goes, right? You say something, I say something, you know, you may be intimidated, I may be intimidated. I'm not saying there aren't things that happen, but in general, you want to provoke someone to respond, and then they respond, and that's supposed to be a good idea. Anyway, I wrote back, and then they wrote back, and only 20 professors joined the last letter today. And I thought, well, this is the hopeless core. I'm not writing back. I dealt with 120. Okay. I also think that molding, I mean, it may be different, you know, in a small, you know, college, liberal arts college, but I found in a large public university, it's very impractical and ineffective to try to mold the students sort of directly. I mean, oftentimes we had a noose incident at San Diego, someone mentioned the other day, and there are other incidents. You know, when you have 180,000 employees and 250,000 students, anything that can happen will happen eventually. But there often are demands for courses on tolerance and on history of this or that. And I'm not per se against it, but I'm just telling you, the bigots tend not to pay attention. That was my experience. It just doesn't always seem to work. I also don't believe in the nanny university. I mean, you know, safe rooms with candy and cookies and padded walls. So I would say, you know, my view is really the in loco parentis doctrine is dead. The in loco parentis is just loco today. I mean, that is my view of it. Now, I don't know Antioch, and I can't say that there aren't, you know. But, three-quarters of all students go to public universities in America. Most of them, by the way, don't have the choices that people have described. They go to their local universities. They go to the local community colleges. It's even more influential location than our finances and so forth. That's just the way it is. So what do we want our community colleges to look like? And there are a lot of students there, and our big public universities and our small public universities. And what do we want for the Stanfords of the world and others to choose to go that route? And I would say we want to have this free exchange of ideas and socialization of those values. So I'll add just a couple of other things. I don't know where, you know, Chicago is an interesting case with it. It'd be interesting to see what Marianne has to say about it. You know, when you're a university president, you are under tremendous pressure to speak out as these events occur. President Napolitano, she felt she had to speak out on the sexual harassment incidents at Berkeley. She would have been pilloried for not saying anything. And you have a racial incident or a homophobic incident or anti-Semitic incident. I mean, all sorts of bad things happen because the community, various communities, get unhappy with you. They say, well, where's the moral leadership? And so that's just a reality. And if you were silent during that time, the administration comes in for criticism and from the legislature and so forth. If you do speak out, of course, you're also in trouble. And you get the people, like I mentioned at UCLA, say you violated their academic freedom because you spoke out against something. And then sometimes it's really very hard to keep up in the race for empathy from the administration. You know, you issue a statement on one day condemning something that's homophobic, and they say, wait a minute, just yesterday someone scrawled something on the door of an Asian American woman at UCLA and you missed it. Well, you know, you have imperfect information systems. It's almost impossible, given the size of the enterprise, to deal with every act of bigotry and discrimination at one time. So there's low tolerance to that. Another fact is, which I won't press that hard, but you all should understand that there is an exception to the First Amendment, a clear exception. and that is high academic administrators do not have First Amendment rights. Larry Summers learned that the hard way. It doesn't matter. I'm speaking in my personal capacity. Doesn't matter. What you say is what you say. And actually, it was Stephen Trachtenberg at George Washington University who mentioned that. So what you say is you need a Miranda warning before you take one of these jobs, if any of you are so distressed as to do that. And the last thing I wanted to say about the poor condition of the First Amendment, and I don't know, I mean, there was a Pew survey that something like 60-70% of students who were surveyed felt it was all right to silence people if they made them uncomfortable. And then I'll tell you one last experience, last war story of the day. I condemned the shouting down of Ambassador Michael Oram at UC Irvine. And they wouldn't let him speak for an hour, and it was tough. He ended up speaking, and you know, it all worked out, and actually the kids were prosecuted by the local DA. The university had nothing to do with that. We didn't support that. And then there were a couple of other incidents. And so anyhow, I had a meeting with the elected leaders, not the campus leaders, but the system-wide leaders of the University of California, student leaders. And they remonstrated with me that I had gotten it wrong. And I said, well, for criticizing the shouting, the effort to silence the speaker. And I said, well, how did I get it wrong? And bottom line, I mean, essentially what they said, and they called me afterwards to tell me, just in case I wasn't clear. They told me that the First Amendment was for marginalized peoples. It was not for privileged peoples. And I was apparently privileged. I was an administrator. I was, I don't know. I was Jewish. I was an administrator. I was just someone with whom they disagreed. So it is a project that is infinitely worth doing, this project of democratic socialization. It is eminently worth doing in the public schools and, you know, with exceptions and variations in the private schools to make sure that we continue our constitutional traditions, because I think they are extremely important. And it's hard to know how deep this is, but I have the feeling that some of these rights are on life support at the moment. That is just my view. Now, maybe 10 years from now, they'll see it differently. It seems as if a lot of my friends in the 60s who were anti-Vietnam became Reagan Republicans for reasons I never understood. But maybe people change, ideas change, cultures change. But I'm very worried about it. And I think what universities do is probably more important than what they say. And by protecting free speech and by protecting academic freedom, they do send a message. And I'm 3 minutes early. Thank you.
We'll use that 3 minutes to allow comments by the panelists as to what the other persons have said, if you'd like to make some.
One comment. Try to make it brief. It's actually about the Larry Summers incident and the exception to the First Amendment. I don't think it's an exception. I think the Larry Summers case was actually a watershed moment for freedom of speech in universities. You all may remember this. At a closed-door discussion, Larry Summers was exploring with other economists why it is that women were underrepresented in the sciences, but not in the social sciences or humanities, and not in not business, law, and medicine. In the course of his remarks, he floated three hypotheses. One of the hypotheses was that because women are distributed differently with regard to various qualities, including high theoretical intelligence, there are fewer women at both ends of the tail, fewer female morons, but fewer women with high theoretical intelligence. Summers rejected that hypothesis. He said, that's not the explanation. The probable explanation, he said, was that brilliant young women, ages 22 or 23, look at the various career paths, and they see the longest career path to security and stability is natural sciences, whereas law, business, medicine, you can be secure roughly in your early 30s as opposed to 40 years in the sciences, and therefore they choose that. Larry Summers, and when controversy erupted, instead of evoking the principle at the university that the purpose of the university to is explore hypotheses. Larry Summers apologized, and he apologized repeatedly. This was this fundamental blunder in accepting that it was inappropriate to, in this case, raise and reject a hypothesis that was unpopular. Instead of defending his right, the former Secretary of Treasury, the president of Harvard University, he acquiesced in the idea that there's some hypotheses, even if you wish to reject them, that are inappropriate for university professors and college presidents to deal with. He needed to defend freedom of expression.
I wasn't going to say anything about what the panelists said in their actual 15 minutes, but I do have to say something about Larry Summers. First of all, I think where Peter began is exactly one of the problems I've had throughout this whole session. And actually, Mark did it as well. It's not about the First Amendment. Larry Summers is the president of a private university. The First Amendment has nothing to do with it. It's not even a California private university where there's a state law saying that the private schools have to also afford a certain level of freedom of speech. And it is not inappropriate to suggest that Larry Summers should be doing his job, which is first and foremost as the president of Harvard, and this is not the sort of thing that I as a Harvard graduate, that I as a professor would have wanted to see him do in a world in which his own project was to encourage more women in STEM fields. And if he's not speaking in his role as a president of the university, then he's only trained as an economist. Economics isn't even as seamless a web as law. He has no expertise to opine on this. This is basically simply a statement of opinion, not a statement of academic research protected by academic freedom. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that free speech doesn't apply to us academics mouthing off about subjects in which we are not academically qualified to speak. But I think it is important to note that Larry Summers was not speaking professionally as either an economist or as the president of Harvard. And if he was speaking as the former, he was doing so in ways that, for the project of the university, I think he was right to apologize.
Mark, you want to weigh in on that? All right.
It's not bound by the First Amendment.
Let's turn to questions from the audience.
When it comes to the Yale case, the idea that it was just pure free speech isn't true. I mean, what was happening in that is there were students who were demanding that first Erica Christakis be fired, and the claims were also, one, that she be fired from the dormitory. Some were more or less saying she should leave the university. Oh. Then after the confrontation at Silliman, they were demanding that Nick Christakis step down, but that he also be fired. And this all happened, this all started on October 30th. It wasn't until a email, until November 18th, after a lot of prodding from FIRE, a lot of prodding from other organizations, from donors, that they finally said, these professors will not be fired. They will not be disciplined in any way. And I have to tell you, that was a really long time for it to go. Meanwhile, the actual result has been that Erica Christakis has said she's never going to teach again because she feels like the university really didn't have her back, and they were basically forced to say that they would support her rights by public outcry, and Nick Christakis is currently on sabbatical. So I think the idea that
I'm now completely lost as to what's speech and what's
demanding someone be fired requires a response.
Right, the response, as you say,
which took till November 18th. No. So, but the
and
idea
the
that this had nothing to do with anything
the
other than
one at a time, please. This isn't Fox News.
So honestly, I am now baffled as to what is counter speech and what is not. These are students. They're not even donors. They're certainly not people in power of the administration. Why is it not speech for them to say, our view is that someone who has said and done these things should not hold a position in our university, and in particular, a position as the head of our little university family, the college, okay? That's speech. You may not agree with it. And what you said about Erica Christophus is exactly what is said about the minority students who feel that they've been microaggressed against. You're saying that her feelings were such that she, doesn't want to teach again. Not that any action was taken to prevent her from teaching other than speech. Now, again, we can have a debate about whether the response to speech being more speech has its limits and whether some kinds of speech are different from other kinds of speech, but it's speech, 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 speech.
They were demanding that she be fired, and it took until November 18th for the university, at a time that administrators all over the country were being fired or leaving their jobs because they had misspoken it.
Right. I mean, as I understand the First Amendment, Brandenburg has already come up. Demanding that someone be killed is protectable speech, so long as I don't do it in a situation where it's a true threat or there's an imminent likelihood that they will be killed.
Well, there's ambiguity that she might be fired. It looks very well, like her and her husband actually very well could be. It behooves the university to actually say it very quickly.
Students are not entitled to lobby for what it is they think is the correct result?
They're saying that students should be fired for their speech. Yeah, that's wrong.
It's wrong to say it? It may be wrong to do it, and the university didn't do it.
That's why the university needs to kick in immediately and say, we're not firing anybody just for what they're saying. And it took them 3 weeks.
So no opinion is out of bounds except the opinion that some opinions are out of bounds.
That demanding someone be fired is something that responds immediate speech from the university saying this person is not going to be fired for their speech.
Greg is not saying that the students' opinions were out of bounds. Greg is saying that the university's position ought to have been, students, you're misunderstanding the Christakises shouldn't be fired because of their opinions. If I understood Greg.
But then it becomes a demand for immediate, from your perspective, appropriate counter speech. And what I said remains true. All I said was both of these incidents, the Yale Halloween costumes incident and the Georgetown stupid bigot incident, are speech all the way down.
They went the entire period believing that they were going to be fired.
And even if they did, lots of people.
Next question.
We're done with that one?
We're done.
I wasn't done listening to it. I'd like to, is this on? It was on. Can you hear me? Yeah, I'm being censored. I'd like to raise an issue that I know Michael was interested in yesterday. We didn't quite get to it, and I would like Michael to be happy with this conference, that it was a kick-ass conference and everything that you wanted came out. So I'm interested in the mob silencing of speech on campuses. I'm also interested in, I'm going to get to this question in a moment, of the disinviting campus speakers. We saw this with Condoleezza Rice, we saw this with Christina Lagarde, and then we saw this with something that I was even involved in. It was started off at Brandeis with Ayaan Hirsi Ali, and I did bring Ayaan Hirsi Ali to NYU. before we get to that narrative, there is this other piece that happened at Yale University in connection with a book about the Mohammed cartoons. This was even before Charlie Hebdo. This was during the first wave, the Danish cartoons. It wasn't the Charlie Hebdo cartoons. This was the Danish cartoons, the first series of these. And there was a book that Yale University Press put out, and they declined to publish the cartoons. So they put on a book about the cartoons and didn't show the cartoons. When I was bringing Ayaan Hirsi Ali, I was essentially told, well, we don't really want her here. And I actually brought her to the 92nd Street Y. Wow. Under the theory that, now it's not that she had never spoken there before, but there was such incredible widespread protests. Students had since submitted letters with tremendous misspellings. It mattered to me. It didn't matter to the dean. The misspellings to me disqualified everything. But I just can't take someone seriously if they can't get that right. And it just also proved that they were citing the same letter. I don't even know if anyone read the letter. But we ended up moving it to the 92nd Street Y. This is all after the Brandeis. By the way, the room was packed. It was live streamed around the world. She received a 25-minute standing ovation. But I can also tell you that there were bomb-sniffing dogs all throughout the auditorium, and they circled the entire square block of the 92nd Street Y repeatedly. I can also tell you that she arrived in three armored cars on that day. So when we talk about the free exchange of ideas in the modern era, I think, and Mark perhaps can answer this, this raises a whole new level. This is not the mob silencing of ideas. This is the bombs silencing of ideas. I don't even know whether the universities actually have a responsibility to say to the students, in the spirit of what we've discussed today and yesterday, we think free speech is so important and academic freedom is so important that we're going to risk the bombs because we want you to know how we roll on campus. And ideas matter to us. And we will welcome people. We won't send them to other venues. We welcome them here. So I don't know, Mark, perhaps you faced this in other ways. I know people attempted to strangle you once. I don't know if they attempted to bomb you. I don't know if you've ever seen, I had never seen this before. I'd never seen the armored cars. I had never, and I've hosted events at the 92nd Street Y for nearly 20 years. And in all of those years, and we've had everybody, we did not have bomb sniffing dogs everywhere, in the balconies, throughout, in the backstage, in the green room, everywhere, because this woman, who in my mind, among other things, is a human rights advocate, an activist was attempting to speak. Anyway,
the I'll just answer briefly. I mean, the name of the game has changed. I did not have experience with bombs. We did have a car blow up in my driveway after some protest earlier, but they decided the car, which was cold, had not been run, spontaneously blew up. The neighbors did not buy that explanation. They were very happy when we left the neighborhood. I think the name of the game has changed. If you look at the UC Davis incident recently, if you look at San Francisco State, not far from here, these were very threatening. I mean, these were mob situations where people were really in harm's way. I mean, they really were. And there was an incident in Chicago with the there was a conference, an LGBT conference, and and people had to flee the room. And so one of the things, I'm just telling you, one of the things, I think that's a bigger, that's the biggest threat. I mean, we don't need to get into the nuance of free speech, but people who want to physically prevent other people. And I just had a correspondence with Columbia, your rival across town. I think we need the universities to be much more attentive to our protocols and how we deal with this. That's one point. The second point is, I'm not against inviting controversial people, and that's fine, but I think we ought to think about it before we do. I mean, it's like PICO and library books. You know, you don't have to buy every book, but you don't deshelve it after you purchased it. I think once you, Thane, or someone else in authority has made a commitment for a speech, you ought to live with it and do what you can to carry through. But I think it's a tragedy that you... You mean that you cannot have a range of people coming to campus? I just can't imagine some of these presidential candidates coming to some campuses. You would need an army to protect them, and that wasn't always the case. I mean, I think of speeches by Eisenhower and Kennedy and other people. I mean, that was a typical forum for many of our presidents and presidential candidates.
Peter.
Very, very quickly, I don't think universities are under an obligation to expose their students or their faculty to threats of physical violence. But if it ever, whenever again it comes to that, it seems to me it is incumbent upon the university president to speak out loudly and forcefully and eloquently against this threat of physical violence and the damage that is being done to freedom of, forget the First Amendment, the freedom of expression, which is central to liberal education. And there are things that can be done. For example, why can't we imagine a coalition of college and university professors writing joint op-eds for our major national newspapers denouncing such incidents I presume it did not happen in the case of Ayaan Hirsi Ali.
I cannot tell you how painful it is to tell you the number of faculty members at NYU who thought that she's a war criminal and that actually think that this woman, she should not speak anywhere. The numbers of faculty, but admittedly, their letters were had proper spelling. But still, the number of faculty members, there is no way we could have gotten a gathering of NYU professors that would have supported her on that day, any day. They just wouldn't have spoken out. It was so, it's so unfashionable to say that. By the way, just to give you another example, this was true of Michael Mukasey, who I did bring to campus and received the exact same treatment, although he didn't, we actually brought him to campus, and there were protests outside, and this was because he was deemed a war criminal for the torture memorandum. And this is a former federal judge who, you know, was the Attorney General of the United States, and there was a real significant, not quite what we saw with Ayaan Hirsi Ali, but the same idea, lots of students, lots of faculty encouraging the students. So yes, I don't know. That would have been a great thing. I can't imagine it happening.
So can I say two things? First, on the threat of violence, one of the civil liberties we haven't talked about is Second Amendment rights. And I think we need alcohol back on the campuses, lower the drinking age to 18, and we need guns off the campuses. And you know, there have been issues of civil liberties on campus where professors have been told, now that there are open carry laws, be careful what you say in class. This is a civil liberty, I think, that can be safely and should, in the interests of safely, not be exercised at the university. Then secondly, on the issue of controversial speakers, I think it's incumbent on universities to make clear the range of capacities in which speakers are invited, because there certainly are at my university certain speakers who are invited with the endorsement of the university. Distinguished lecturers for which the program says we invite people precisely we think well of, or honorary degree candidates. There are others that are invited by student groups, and the university should make clear what level of discretion is given to the students and then stand by it. And then thirdly, there are speakers that the university may invite, and different, again, universities may have different programs, either bringing in people who are sympathetic to the project or precisely bringing in people who are not. But being clear about those various pockets of potential invitation, I think, is important.
I'm just also curious, does anyone want to comment on that Yale University book about the Danish cartoons? Does anyone actually think that the publishing house had an obligation to actually publish the cartoons?
Obligation? No, but I would have published them if I had been the editor of the press.
All right, next question.
So, if we're going to have a panel that talks about the molding of young minds, the issue of who's doing the molding strikes me as interesting. Picking up on Professor Berkowitz's remarks, a simple Google search that I did while in my seat revealed that by a 6-to-1 margin, university professors regard themselves as liberal or leaning left. Political donations among university professors in the Ivy League skew 99% to Democrats, 1% to Republicans. With diversity being a goal but not being achieved among faculty and administrators at major universities, does this present a problem in terms of who is doing the molding, and are they doing so fairly?
I'll begin. I'm strongly opposed to making faculty hiring on the basis of political leanings. I don't think we should be looking into that when we're seeking to hire faculty or admit students, whatever. It seems to me the way to go is to ensure that the curriculum presents both sides of the argument. It might have been Mark, I don't remember, who said it's not so concerned about whether Catholic universities teach pro-choice view. Well, I'm very concerned that at our leading universities, it's very hard to study the pro-life view. It seems to me that faculty and administrators do have a responsibility to see that the curriculum does represent both sides. If you do that, in the nature of things, it will probably turn out that you'll have more conservatives on your faculty, because as it happens, for a variety of reasons, conservative people who lean conservative have more interest in studying and mastering conservative ideas. But again, I would focus on filling places in curricular slots and not asking after candidates' political allegiances.
Anybody else? Or shall we go to the next question?
Hi, thank you for this really wonderful panel. I personally, at least, believe that a really important thing when you're dealing with having a fully liberal education is confronting ideas which are not just politically different, but in some cases repulsive. I studied the history of science a great deal in college, and in studying the history of science, if you're doing so thoroughly, you're going to come across things that are not just politically different or, you know, on the level that Professor Berkowitz has been talking about, but actually repulsive ideas. And I think that it is important and that those ideas be presented in the classroom as they were to me. So my question really is twofold. First, do you think that this is becoming lesser, that it's becoming harder to present ideas that are really of that nature, that are really necessary to understand the entirety of a topic? And second, given the pressures that you've been talking about on the panel, how do you think those ideas can continue to be presented and continue to be exposed so that somebody can have a full understanding of a subject, including the ideas that ultimately are not within the range of something that's widely accepted today?
Do you have an example of a really repulsive idea?
Yeah, I could say a lot of the eugenics ideas. If you're studying the history of science in the 20th century, you have to, I think it's important to understand eugenics and how the ideas of eugenics came out and emerged in both, you know, American thought and in foreign thought. And to be exposed to that text, if you're a historian of that, I think that is very important to see.
I mean, I, as a constitutional lawyer, find myself talking about eugenics a fair amount. I thought you were actually going in a different direction, which responds a bit to part of the problem about representing all sides or both sides. There are repulsive ideas that are merely politically repulsive, but within the history of science, there are ideas that are simply wrong. I will refrain from suggesting that facts have a well-known liberal bias, but I will say that there is such a thing as a fact, right? And that the debates about teaching both intelligent design and evolution have problems that are not exhausted by the public schools establishment clause issue, and get to the point that, well, many things are up for debate in science, and many ideas in the history of science are old and new again, or not yet accepted, it does not make sense in a science classroom at any level to teach both the possibility that the Earth is more than 6,000 years old and the possibility that it is no more than 6,000 years old.
I'm talking more specifically about in the humanities, talking about this. I'm not saying in a biology classroom, I'm talking about a history classroom, a philosophy classroom where you're looking at older texts.
I understand the problem. I don't have a solution for you, because sometimes the remedies are worse than the wrongs in terms of the sort of supervision that you were needing classes to make sure they were balanced and cover these ideas. But I do think it's a problem. I think, by the way, students are pretty mature. They can handle it and so forth. But, I mean, I'll give you an example of what I think is a problem. I've talked to a number of criminal law professors. I'm just back into the law school world. I was engaged in crime for 5 years, so I figure I'm an expert. I was told by two well-known criminal law professors that most criminal law professors, or many, I don't know the exact proportion, do not teach rape in class because some of their students feel very uncomfortable with that, and they just omit it from the curriculum. Now, I mean, you know, it could be controversial in terms of how you present it or how graphic it is or how insulting it is, but most people would think if you're going to teach criminal law, this is an important area where heinous misdeeds occur, and that you need to know the rules, right, and how it works, if only to reform them if you don't like them. So I do think it is a problem, but I maybe some other panelists have. But I think most of the remedies are worse than the problem itself.
Actually, I want to go back to the solution I suggested. Every student admitted to Bolt Hall should receive a letter that among the subjects you may study are criminal law. When you study criminal law, rape will be taught. if you don't want to go to Boat Hall and study criminal law and rape, there are lots of other law schools to go to. But insofar as you believe, you cannot study, you cannot understand the criminal law without understanding the crime of rape, and I presume the majority of Boat Hall law professors believe that, it seems to me this is an easy solution to that problem.
Professor Sudvalik.
So one question that came up on this panel, which is in general I think a very interesting question, is when criticism itself merits being criticized and merits being argued to be out of bounds. And I take it one of the reasons that we're thinking about this is the sort of the social context, that we could have had a situation where we really did think, you know, all sorts of universities should operate differently. It's perfectly legitimate to call for firing of people for various things. You know, then they'll just sort it to different places. But I take it that one experience, at least for, I wasn't around, but that is understood about the 60s and the 70s, and the early 70s, is that there was this sense that, well, no, that certain kinds of, say, calls for people to be fired because of their speech in certain situations were things that people had the free speech right to say, but those calls were themselves rightly condemned as damaging. So I wanted to just pose this hypothetical. Imagine that at a university that somehow manages to have a conservative administration, but one let's assume is not a religious university, but something kind of like Yale, but just happens to have a well-known conservative administration. And somebody complains, and the students have a rally and demand and such to say, we are outraged that this person who supervising the dorm. He's been talking about white privilege. He's been talking about how America has done all these horrible things. He's been talking about how religion is irrational. We are outraged. We're appalled. It makes us feel unsafe and unwelcome here as whites, as patriotic Americans, as religious people. We demand that this person be. Now, I should say, I agree entirely this is First Amendment protected. If this person sued for interference with business relations, well, we have NAACP Claiborne Hardware, we know that the speakers would have a perfect First Amendment. How should we react to that? Should we say, hey, it's just speech, there's no reason for us to condemn these people, all that they're doing is speaking, or would we say, this is really something that speech, you're entitled to say this, but it's really damaging to the economy. And if so, is there any difference between that and Yale?
So I'm having a hard time. I mean, I'm not being coy about it. So I'm having a hard time understanding what it is that, for example, FIRE wishes or expects instead should happen. That is to say, again, if it's speech all the way down, FIRE and, you know, whoever, Eugene, you're imagining can add another turtle to the mix, right, and say, we think that's what you just said, right? We think that calling for the firing of someone, even if the people doing the calling are students, has a chilling effect on faculty, and we deplore it. But that's different from, and you might want to persuade the students that, it's inappropriate to do this, that academic freedom should protect them, that they should toughen up. That's all, again, yet another layer of speech. But I'm hearing, perhaps incorrectly, that you are suggesting not that you want to tell the students that the students should silence themselves, or that you want to persuade the students out of feeling that someone like the Christakises should be fired, but that you just think it's inappropriate for, you just think it's inappropriate for the students to speak. You're not willing to engage with them on that subject. You are willing just to condemn them. And the question is, what do you want them to do other than speak? Sit there quietly thinking,
I'll just tell you my perspective. What I expect is moral leadership from the university. Students can speak. They can recommend anyone they want to fire. You know, and they can hold signs and write op-ed pieces and all that. And others may disagree with this. And again, I don't know what Chicago would be like. You have those rules, and I don't know exactly. I've read them. I still don't know entirely what they mean. But you would like a president to say, now, look, I don't agree with all these views on white privilege and religion, or maybe, you know, or maybe you're more agnostic and say, I'm not passing one way or the other on that. But we have a vibrant, robust, intellectual community, and I don't think Snodgrass ought to be fired because of his views. And I would do that both ways, you know, whether it's the Yale situation or the one that Eugene just described.
I think the Yale situation is complicated by the fact that, at least on my radar screen, and as a Yale graduate, my radar screen was flooded, not just, you know, professionally, but because of my personal connections with information about this. No one was calling for the Christakises to lose their academic appointment. All of the debate was about their peculiar role as the heads of these colleges, which, as the student who was pilloried for shouting at Christakis to this effect, are really built by Yale University as a home for the students. And I think that the standards we use to say, if for whatever reason the head of the college has lost the confidence and trust, I mean, even for legitimate or illegitimate reasons, the head of the college has lost the confidence and trust of the students within the college, that's a reason not to have them lose their academic appointment, but to perhaps think about this may not be the job they're suited for, being the head of the college.
I wasn't referring to Yale specifically. I want to be clear, I'm not.
One last comment goes to Peter, and then we've got to call it quits.
Very quickly, I want to distinguish two versions of Eugene's hypothesis. As Marianne said at the very beginning, it's a big and free country. There can be private conservative institutions, and in a conservative college devoted to teaching its students conservative ideas, seems to me the president would be justified. But in any institution that presents itself as devoted to liberal education, of course, even if the president's conservative, he ought to uphold the propriety of heads expressing their various opinions on left and right. Not a hard question.
All right. Thank you very much. Let's applaud the panel. Professor McConnell.
Is this on? So I'd like to thank all the speakers from all of the panels. I've been enormously provoked and stimulated during the course of the conference. When I put together conferences, one thing I try to do is to make the panels on distinctly different topics so that they don't all end up saying the same thing. But they're, and I think that was pretty successful here. But it does lose the connections between things. You know, how does the issue of freedom of speech fit with the issue of sexual assault procedures on campus? And especially how does the substance of sexual assault fit together with the procedures for determining responsibility for claims of sexual assault? So I'm just going to say a couple of things that I noticed about common themes. In both of these areas, we saw a concerted effort to identify some common ground. And I think Michelle Dauber was particularly striking in this with the kitten. I think that was probably the most successful common ground of the whole of the whole conference. But it wasn't the only, and so it seems to me we heard two very important themes that turn out to be, you know, quite similar. And so in the speech panel, no one was an absolutist. Everyone seemed to agree that at some level, sometimes speech amounts to actual harm. I think Thane was the person who most drew upon this theme. And that it is appropriate, maybe even necessary, for authorities, including universities, to intervene when words actually take the form of real harm. And incitement was maybe the greatest example of this. Well, the Supreme Court doesn't disagree. I think much of Supreme Court doctrine is designed, in the speech area, is designed to identify particular types of speech that do provide, that do cause harm. Incitement is one, fighting words, a defamation, real threats. And the court's project has been to provide a sufficiently narrow and sufficiently clear definition of harm that we can protect against the harm without it spilling out, without into speech that's merely offensive. So the court, my former boss, Justice Brennan, wrote in the Texas versus Johnson case that the bedrock principle of the First Amendment is that we don't suppress speech because it is merely offensive. So offense on one side, harm on another. Thane, again, helpfully reminded us of this line. But then there's the problem of what we might call harm creep. That is, yes, there are these narrowly defined matters. The Supreme Court's been very careful to be very narrow about this, but not everybody is so precise. And many people find themselves harmed by speech that is perhaps merely offensive. So just here on Stanford in the last year or so, a couple of examples, maybe these showed my bias, I hope not, but one student organization, undergraduate student organization, wanted to bring in a speaker who was opposed to same-sex marriage, and at the student government meeting where they decided to cut off funding for this speaker, there were students who said, I feel frightened by the thought that someone would make this speech. There have been some recent universities where having Trump's name written in chalk is said to be frightening, right? And so if the idea of harm creeps down into matters like this, then we have really taken the move away from actual harm to mere offense. And I fear that in campuses, I think the very idea of microaggressions is to embrace that erasure of the line, and thus I worry about it. Now, for the sexual assault panel, again, Michelle Dauber said something which I entirely agree with, and I think is a great starting point. When she was asked, what's the point of all this? This was in response to Artemis Seaford's question. You know, what is really the goal? And she said, I'm clear about what the goal is. I want to have a safe campus. Well, that's something I entirely agree with as well. But then when we get into the details of what is a safe campus, and we begin talking about the definitions, it turns out that that we're actually intervening in cases that don't have a lot to do with safety. They have to do with power dynamics. They have to do with courtesy. I'm inclined to think that a lot of the times they have to do with chivalry or the lack thereof, boorishness. That we are setting up a standard that is demanding enough that essentially all bad behavior becomes objectionable, whether it has anything to do with safety or not, that no one is actually quaking in their boots at the possibility that there may be flirtatious conduct, right? That they're entitled to turn off at any moment, but the very fact that it happens is it seems to me to say that raises a safety question is about the same as saying that microaggressions are an actual form of harm. And the panel that surprised me the most, and therefore provoked me the most, was the one about definitions, in which, if I heard the speakers correctly, they all said something along the lines of this affirmative consent is coming. It is coming, as if whether something comes is like the tides, right? I don't think that adoption of radical new laws that govern our conduct are like the tide. I think this is a question for discussion, and we ought to wonder, is this a good idea or not? And some of the, my old friend, Bob Weisberg, we go way back to 1979 when we were co-clerks, so he would, he's not here anymore, but you know, this is not personal, but you know, he admits that he doesn't know what affirmative consent really means, and in response to a very good student question, he said, all what it really amounts to in practice is a shift in the burden of proof. Oh, nobody's jaws seemed to drop. That was just sort of accepted. It's a shift in the burden of proof. But what does that mean? I think what that means is we are doing away with the presumption of innocence. And to my mind, if that's the step we are taking, we're doing away with the presumption of innocence for very serious punishment. I mean, if this amounted to just a talking to in the dean's office, but you know, when we're talking about very serious punishment, to do away with the presumption of innocence strikes me as a major step that demands more public consideration and more thought, and indeed, I think, is not a step that we ought to be taking. But then, so these are the, I saw these themes of safety and harm as being very similar. In both cases, it's a sound principle that then gets watered down to the point that it seems to me to be a bit dangerous. But then there was a third theme, and this keeps coming up, but was especially the subject of the last panel. And the third theme is that, well, universities are special. And I think of what Jeannie Suk said at one point when being, after talking about how students really won't know what affirmative consent means, and but maybe 20 years from now there'll be a process in which it becomes clear over time. And then she said that what we're doing is, well, I didn't bring my notes, but she said, we're teaching people, we're teaching students to be good persons. And then Mark Yudof reminds us, well, of course, universities are engaged in socialization. And Peter Berkowitz says, of course, universities are engaged in moral education. And all of this strikes me as quite true. But note that when we're talking about this function of the university, we are no longer protecting other students from harm, whether it's harm from speech or harm to their safety. We're talking about now the object of regulation is the student who is being disciplined. And the purpose of the discipline is not just to make sure that no harm is inflicted on third parties, but to make that person a better person. And this makes a great deal of sense to me. I'm not sure I endorse it, but at least I understand it, right? But I do think that if that is what we are talking about, that there are two things that at least I would want to see made a whole lot clearer than have been made clear. One is these are not standards that should go beyond the university out to the outside world. It scares me. It's one thing to say that universities dealing with young people ought to have nebulous standards like affirmative consent and ought to suppress speech which is, you know, hurtful and offensive, right? Because we're teaching people to be nice to one another, and it's one thing, but we ought to be very clear that we're not talking about the law. We are not talking about the government. We're not talking about the state or society, that this is because the university has a special role with respect to its students. That's the first point. And the second point is that it seems to me that insofar as we're talking about this educative function, building good citizens, teaching people to be better persons, that the punishments, the discipline involved should not be something that is a permanent, severe penalty on their entire lives, right? I think, you know, so discipline for students, what should it be? You know, I don't have an answer to that. But things that are going to be on their record that are going to mean that they cannot have a life is just too much. And so maybe if we scale down the sanctions, it would be, we could have a lot more understanding of maybe more arbitrary, less a little bit more vagueness, a little bit more discretion. Maybe we don't have to worry about lawyering up. It won't be necessary for Andrew to be representing students because, you know, it's an educative process. It's not punishment. But it seems to me that the universities are embarking on a course of action which is punitive in nature, and then when they are called on it, when people like Andrew say, oh, well, if it's going to be punitive, we have to have due process, we have to have clear, understood definitions, then they retreat to the defense of, oh, no, we're just educating, right? Well, it can't be both ways. Seems to me that I can understand moving beyond real harm and real safety to forming better citizens. But if we do that, it seems to me the universities need to be less punitive, that it can't be both, because mixing the two just doesn't, I don't think it conforms with the dictates of a free society. So with that, thank you for attending. Thank not just the three of you, but all of the speakers for speaking. And let's have one final round of applause for all the speakers.